reasoning our way to non-duality. But it didn't work. We tried reasoning our way to non-duality, but it didn't work. But the moment, that moment we gave up, no obstacle remained. The one introduced himself to us out of kindness. How else could we have known it? Reason took us to the door, but it was presence that let us in. Reason took us all the way to the door, but it was presence that let us in. But how will you ever know the one as long as you are unable to know yourself? Once one is one, no more, no less, error begins with duality. Unity knows no error. Once one is one, no more, no less. Error begins with duality. Unity knows no error. Place itself has no place. How could there be place for the creator of place? How could there be heaven for the maker of heaven? God said, I was a hidden treasure, so creation was created, so that you, yes, you, might know me, the one. So why tell me that what you seek does not exist in any place? Why tell me if what you're seeking is nowhere to be found? Do you propose to travel there on foot? The road yourself must journey on lies in polishing the mirror of your heart. Knowing what you know, be serene also like a mountain. Be serene like a mountain, and do not be distressed by misfortune. Knowledge without wisdom is an unlit candle. Together they are honeycomb. Honey without wax is a noble thing. Wax without honey is only fit for burning. The pure man unites two in one. The lover unites three in one. The lover unites three in one. But tonight, I am frightened. Yes, tonight I am frightened. Lest our ignorance and stupidity leave us all stranded on the bridge. The lover unites three in one, but tonight I am frightened. Tonight, yes, I am frightened, lest our ignorance and stupidity leaves us all stranded on the bridge. So let's not get stranded on the bridge. I welcome you back to find the way across the rest of the bridge. We ended the first half of the talk with the need to move from IQ to EQ, and then from IQ to EQ to WeQ. Recognize that we are all inseparable members of the one body of the human family. But now we must journey on further. We must move from IQ to WeQ, to the more than WeQ, to the more than human world that gives us our life and our sustenance. Hazrat Inayat Khan, who was the person who brought Sufism from the Shisti Sufi line in India with his music to the West, and the Shisti line is one always that it has music at its heart and in its soul. Hazrat Inayat Khan, who wrote, he came over in 1908, I think I've got a year right, he said there is only one holy book, and that is the sacred manuscript of nature, the only scripture which can enlighten the reader, whoever they are. And Sa'di, one of the great poets of Persia, wrote, every leaf of a tree, every leaf of a tree becomes the page of the book when once the heart is opened and it has learned to read. This Bible is everywhere and always available. There are many holy books in Bibles, each designed to provide guidance for a particular localized niche at a particular time. The Quran, channeled by the Prophet Muhammad for the Arabs in the 7th century. The New Testament, based on the teachings of Jesus for the people of the Mediterranean of his time. Buddha for the people of northern India 2,500 years ago. Yes, they all transcended their place and time with their teaching. But we have turned their living words into dogma and into idols, in ways that divided us into tribes of belief. The only holy book that we all share in our one globalized niche, the only Bible that unites us rather than divides us, is the holy book of creation and of nature. And it is this we will return. One of the first lessons of this holy book is that life gives of itself freely. You cannot monetize a drop of rain, or tie down a ray of sunshine to an economic value. Everything in nature gives of itself. The cloud dissolves as it delivers its rain, as manna from the heavens. The sun burns itself up, as if continuously, without break, providing light and heat without boundary or favouritism. And the rose dies into its flowering and into its perfume. Only through all suns and stars dying did the universe first create carbon. And carbon is one of the fundamentals to all living systems on this earth and others. The death truly creates life. Only by giving something away do we have it. And only by embracing death could we fully live. A few years ago, where we live on the edge of Bath because we grow and eat our own animals. This was a kind of quite a tough spiritual practice of loving an animal in life and then actually naming it and eating it by name as you eat it. So I created this simple little grace. As a moment of indwelling practice as we eat. We give thanks for all that dies that we might live. We also give thanks for all that lives that we might die. And in partaking in this food, we realize and remember that life and death are one. I'm going to offer you a little, very simple practice that you can do with food. I want you to close your eyes. For those who haven't had dinner, this may be difficult, but I'd like you to close your eyes and picture the last dinner you ate, the last plate of rich food. Maybe lunchtime, maybe an hour ago, maybe yesterday, maybe several days ago. And I want you to hold that plate in your hands in front of you, visualizing it. I want you to notice the many colors and smell the rich aromas. Breathe in the smells of the food, the warmth, the aromas. Say thank you for the food. And as you carry on picturing it and smelling it, I want you to say thank you for those who prepared and cooked it. It may have been yourself. Say thank you for those who may have done the shopping. Say thank you for those who worked in the shops, both selling you the food and stacking the shelves by night, to then go back further, take one item of the food and think of the journey it went on to arrive in the shop. To say thank you for those who transported it over land and sea to bring it to you. To then take an item of food and take it further back. To picture where it grew. To say thank you for those who harvested it and packed it. And take it further back to the beginning of its living life as an animal or plant or grain. And say thank you for those who planted the seeds and who prepared the soil. And then go into that soil, provided the food for the animals and for the plants, and say thank you to the worms and the microbes that worked the soil. Say thank you to the sun, the wind, the rain that provided the energy for the planet, for the plants to grow. Say thank you to the stars that died without whom we would have no calm. All the way back to the dying of constellations and the whirling of the cosmos. To say thank you, for we are all stardust partaking in stardust. As the opening poem said, we are all breath, breathing the one breath. So this is a practice we can all do as a pause before we eat, to rejoin our consciousness, to our participatory consciousness, with the world that provides us 99.9% of all the value of our life and asks no cost of us, except to do what is ours to do. So I invite you back. For now, that poem with Mike's lovely music, we talked about bringing the two to one. For at the heart of Sufism, the quest of the Sufi, the enlightened being, is to have a taste of the oneness of creation that never leaves them. In the words of Ibn al-Arabi, the Sheikh al-Arsheikh, this is a station, not a state. But what about us ordinary mortals, unlike the great poets and the great realized beings? But Ibn al-Arabi would tell us, how can we be ordinary? How can we possibly be ordinary mortals when we are all part of the one? But also, how can we be special when we are all part of the one? Or more successful when we are all part of the one? In much of the writing, the Sheikh does help us battle with the great dualities of philosophy, theology, ontology, and the great dualities of everyday human existence. The separation of God and creation. How can they be separate? Immanence and transcendence, good and evil, light and dark, limited being and delimited being. This word that he uses a lot. The one and the many. Ibn al-Arabi shows us how the path to realization is in reconciling the opposites. And to do that, we have to spot them as they pop up in our thinking, as they pop up. I work a lot with leadership teams, and I have never met a leadership team that did not have a stuck either-or debate going on in its regular discourse. Once you start to notice them, you find them everywhere in our common language. The creation of separation. Language does that for us. How do we both create separation and dissolve it? William Chittick, the great scholar of Ibn al-Arabi, writes, no one will find true knowledge of the nature of things by seeking explanations in either or. The real situation will have to be sought in both and, or perhaps more importantly, in neither nor. Ambiguity does not grow up simply from our ignorance. Ambiguity is a fact at the heart of things, inherent in the nature of cosmos. Nothing is certain but being itself. Yet it, the one being, is the coincidence of all opposites. The Sufi concept, Jam al-Adad, bringing all opposites together in one single reality. To explain, we have to divide. To experience, we have to bring back together. The one reality in all its qualities, in its descent and in its degrees, accepts the opposites because, from its point of view, there is no such thing as an opposite. The people of the Gnosis, this is just a hint. But for them, it is enough. That is the words of the Gnosis. The people of Gnosis, this coincidence of opposites is just a hint. But for them, it is enough. The path of Tawhid, which is the path of union, lies in realization. The transcendence and immanence, Ibn al-Arabi writes, are two fundamental aspects of one reality as we know it. Neither would be sufficient without the other. The Haq, the one true reality of transcendence, is asserted. This is the same as the Kaf, the plurality of existence, of whom immanence is asserted. But you see, this isn't just about philosophy. It's not just about how do we have Hegelian dialectics or Ibn al-Arabi overcoming of philosophical opposites. It's something that we have to experience in the moment. Whether this comes from an intuitive flash of lightning, whether from the sky, or whether it comes, as it did for Ibn al-Arabi, in the flashing white teeth of the smile of his earthly beloved, the beautiful Nizam, whom he meets in Mecca. Tawhid is a movement in the heart. It's a tent where the opposites make love one to the other. It's not both and, it's neither nor. Where the opposites make love one to another until there is only one. It is the opening to the oneness. And this is how Ibn Arabi describes overcoming duality in earthly love. His poem about his meeting with Nizam, who comes from a very different whole ethnic group than he does.
She is the daughter of Iraq, the daughter of my imam, and I, her opposite, a child of Yemen. O my lord, have you seen the two opposites are ever united? Had you seen us at Rama proffering each other cups of passion without fingers, while passion caused sweet and joyous words to be uttered between us without a tongue? Then you would have seen a state in which the understanding disappears. Yemen and Iraq embracing together.
So he beautifully crafts this dissolving of philosophical polarities, the dissolving of groups in conflict with each other, and the dissolving of a man and a woman in love at that moment. And this is at the heart of Sufism. How do we experience all those levels? If Rumi takes us into the heart, and Ibn Arabi shows us the keys to unlocking philosophical complexity, it's the actual melting of the two that brings the true opening of the path. We are one human family, as we hear in that echo, where through love, both otherness and duality dissolve. So the seventh, and for many the most precious, is the way of love. But the way of love, which is about perpetual transformation, taqwana. Four is, Ibn Arabi teaches us, self-disclosure never, but never repeats itself. The renewal of creation is at every instant. There was a great Sufi teacher who, a student, traveled many miles to see, and he said, "What is the wisdom you can teach me?" And the teacher said, "All my wisdom, but all my wisdom is on this one ring." And the student said, well, teach me. He took off his ring, and there on the inside of his ring was written, "This too will pass." Mm-hmm. He said, "This is my teacher." But in my life, I have found it far easier to repeat that when things are bad. What is hard is to remember to say it when things are going well. In the Quran, it is written, there is no end to the manifestation of the oneness. The one at every moment is in a different configuration. So we're now going to hear Ibn Arabi's beautiful concept of taqwa, love which can love every moment as it arises. For this word, taqwala, has its roots in both the word for heart and the word for change, brought together. The heart receives each instant and all forms. So again, we're going to hear from Ibn Arabi about the path of life.
Pasture between breastbone and innards. Marvel. A garden among the flames. My heart can take on any form. A meadow for gazelles, a cloister for monks, a temple for idols, Kaaba for the circling pilgrim, the tablets of the Torah, the scrolls of the Quran. My creed is love. Wherever its caravan turns along the way, that is my belief, the faith I keep.
Sufi's faith is not rooted in a book or an altar. Sufi's faith is found at every moment on the caravan of travel. So rather than my words, let's hear how Pir Elias comments on this poem.
This famous poem of Ibn Arabi perfectly describes the spontaneity and openness of the path. Our caravan turns however it does, and the open presence welcomes whatever comes. Opening to our innate openness frees us to live in wholeness with everything that is. In wholeness, we spontaneously know what to do. A natural compassion arises in our hearts without any forethought or sentiment. It arises from the shoreless ocean of love that is our unborn identity. This wholeness we are is simply love and its beauty. We are love's beauty. At this level of the open path, words are best left behind.
So paradoxically, I'll add just a few more words. To say, just to make this very practical, because I know there are many counsellors and therapists of one form or another present here, that I think in that work, it is constantly asking ourselves, how do we work not from our knowledge, not from our skill, how do we work from source? Or to put it more rightly, how do we let source do its work through us? To get out of the way and to work with effortless effort from source to source. And to echo that phrase from Pir Elias, how do we welcome all that comes our way? Hazrat Inayat Khan, the founder of the Sufi movement in the West, said that what Hafiz, the poet we'll now turn to, has pointed out from the beginning to end is this. Do not wait for the day to come tomorrow. Communicate with the beloved right now. For the beloved is before you here, sitting next to you, in the form of a friend, or on the other side, in the form of an enemy. And of course, the two are not separate. For as Murshid Fazal used to say, we all need a friend courageous enough to be our enemy, that will make us wake up and become truly alive. To go back to Hazrat, his grandfather, he says, communicate with the beloved now, the beloved before you, here in the form of your friend and in the form of your enemy. The beloved who brings a bowl of poison or a rose. Recognize this and know it. For this is the purpose of life. So let's listen to Hafiz.
Come, for the palace of oak has weak foundations. I give you some advice, learn it, and in practice, remember it. For it comes from my master of the way. Do not seek an honest vow from this fickle world. For the crone is the bride of 1,000 men. Don't fret about the world, and don't forget my advice. For I recall this maxim of love from a fellow traveller. Consent to what has been given, and loosen the knot of your brow, because the door of free will is closed to you and me. The rose's smile bears no trace of loyalty or kept promises. Cry, love a nightingale, this is the place for it. O you who build weak verse,
I be jealous of a Hafiz? To reach the heart, to craft graceful verse, these are gifts from God.
Hafiz, the poor baker's boy, who through falling in love with the rich mayor's daughter, was dining supperless for 39 nights. Some of you may know the story. It's repeated in the film Cinema Paradiso. He was told that he was a poor boy delivering bread, and he fell in love with the rich mayor's daughter. She came out of the house, the most beautiful thing he'd ever seen. And he thought, what can I, a poor baker's boy, do, falling in love with a rich man's daughter? And then somebody told him that there was a Sufi saint buried on the edge of Shiraz. And if he stood there without any supper for 39 nights and stayed awake and had no supper, anything he wished would be granted to him. So he thought, surely this woman is worth doing that. For 39 nights he stood there in the pouring rain and in the cold, getting hungrier and hungrier and more probably hallucinating. And on the last night, his wish was answered. He looked up and he heard a voice saying, Hafiz, what is your wish? And he looked up and he saw the prophet, Gabriel. And the prophet said to him, what is your wish, Hafiz? And he thought, but wait, Gabriel is 1,000 times more beautiful than the most beautiful woman that's ever lived. And when the third time Gabriel said, Hafiz, what is your wish? He thought, wait a moment. If Gabriel is 1,000 times more than the most beautiful girl that's ever lived, how beautiful must God be? So when that third question was asked, Hafiz, what is your wish? He said, give me God, give me God! And Gabriel took him by the hand and he took him through the back streets of Shiraz and he took him to the door of Attar. He knocked on the door and he woke up Attar and said, Attar, this is your new student. May he learn greatly from you. Such a lovely story. Of how do we accept what comes and how do we realise that any moment can be the opening to the path of love. So finally, the last lesson, and probably the most important thing we have to do, as that first poem told us, is to stay awake. Not necessarily for 39 nights, but that's the traditional shut-up. But to stay awake, the lesson it comes each and every day. For, whether you realise it or not, you have all signed up for the University Without Walls. For in this university, entry is free, and you've been signed up since birth, whether you know it or not. The modern teacher, Ram Dass, some of you may have read him, said, it's amazing how many of us sign up at the School of Life and then spend the rest of our lives complaining about the curriculum. I later added to this and said, and life and our eternal teacher are infinitely generous. For in this school, this university, there are endless examination resets. What we fail to learn in one relationship, we will generously be given as the lesson in the next relationship. So remember that before you plan your next divorce. And what we fail to develop in one role in life will come to challenge us within our next role. I have a good Sufi friend in Turkey, and he shared with me as we were getting lost trying to drive to the airport, as our conversation got more and more complex, he said, look, it's amazing that in this university, it's as though we've all got our own individualized teacher somewhere in the unseen world, who is forever compassionate and understanding, and who daily and nightly provides us with learning that is completely tailored to our individual learning style and our exact stage of development. Each day we're sent a new package of action learning, and the many challenges that cross our threshold and arrive via our computers and our smartphones, the people who knock on our doors. Each night, our personal teacher doesn't stop there. They send us a personalized video of metaphorical wisdom and our dreams. Each day, the next lessons arrive. Lessons are everywhere. Our job is simply to stay awake and learn what comes and knocks on our door. Our Sufi murshid or murshida's role, or the role of our therapist or our teacher, is merely, just merely, to connect us with this eternal teacher. Sometimes the Sufi literature is referred to as Kadir, the eternal, ever-present, green teacher. Importantly, it's a green teacher, because it also comes through the ecology in non-human form, daily, with lessons. Nirvana really teaches us how to welcome each and every lesson in as an honored guest.
This being human is a guest house. Every morning, a new arrival, a joy, a depression, a meanness, some momentary awareness comes as an unexpected visitor. Welcome and entertain them all. Even if they're a crowd of sorrows who violently sweep your house empty of its furniture, still treat each guest honorably. He may be clearing you out for some new delight. The dark thought, the shame, the malice. Meet them at the door laughing and invite them in. Be grateful for whoever comes, because each has been sent as a guide from beyond.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Thank you, Laura. I call Julie, I ask all our readers, Anne and Jamila, Nally and Mike. I cannot do justice to the breadth, the depth, and the richness of these great Sufi poets. I hope, though, that tonight we just opened a few cheeks of window into their great reservoir of wisdom. I encourage you to go and feast your soul on the many blessings they have left us. Together we've explored 9 elements, but of course at heart they're only 1. These are ones that I've humbly gleaned from studying their wisdom as best I'm able. The first was to burn our candle brightly and turn our knowledge into wisdom. The second, to develop our adab, our craft, our profession, our unique offering to the world. And then thirdly, be generous in the service to those around us. And to welcome the other is a mirror of a hidden part of ourselves, remembering we are all part of one human family. And since the break, we've talked about dissolving the separation between the human and the more than human world. To notice the dualities that trap our mind and create separation, and to learn to gently dissolve them. To be here, to be now, but also simultaneously to embrace universal space and deep time, remembering all that is finite will pass, and to welcome all that comes, and to find love not in something we cling to, but in moments of every moment being recreated, and finally to stay awake. If there's something that you've heard tonight that's intrigued you, your mind, or it's touched your heart, please follow up with us. Every month at John and Erica's, there is a summer evening with music and poetry and often Zika practice, where we attune to the music of that flows through us and is greater than us. In Anisha Bhav, I provide free sessions of personal guidance. And in June, Pierre Elias, there's some leaflets on all your chairs, will be running a retreat based on free medicine, which we heard read by Mike this evening. Details, if you want more, can be found on the Sufi Way org website. But But before our final poem, with the lovely music of Mike and Ali, our final poem from the Great Ones, please let me offer just a short blessing. May the earth bless you, provide places to rest your heads, fruit to feed you, and the beauty of nature's changing landscapes. May the water bless you, quench your thirst, cleanse your bodies, and bring freshness to your days. May the air bless you, flowing through you as you breathe every breath. The winds blowing new life around you and carrying the music of the spheres to the very drums of your ears. May the fire bless you, bringing the heat, igniting your passion, and burning away the old, that change has space to enter. And may the spirit within and beyond all the elements unite us all in love. And may we together emanate love to all that we meet, both human and more than human, as we leave here this evening. Blessings on you. Thank you for coming. And blessings on the whole human family and on the more than human world in which we have and partake our very being. So, our last poem, the last piece of music from Mike and Ali, a final poem from Hafiz, who discovered the wine of wisdom in the midst of what he called the ruined tavern, his way of describing this world where we all live in the ruined tavern and there need to find sake to bring us the red wine of wisdom. So we end with spring and his flowers. For those of you who wondered why we had daffodils and a glass of red wine here, it is Shiraz wine.
Of the fields of hyacinth flowers.
ripples the beautiful tresses of the hyacinth flowers. From the privacy of the harem, the virgin bud slips out, revealing herself under the morning star. Brandy, your heart and your faith with beauty. And frenzied, Bulbul flies badly out of the house of sadness to unite. Like a thousand trumpets blast. Apis says, and the experienced old ones all concur. Apis, he says, and the experienced old ones all concur. All you really need, yes, all you really need, is to tell others these stories of the fair ones and of the goblet and of the goblet of wine.
More tea or coffee or drinks if anyone wants it or water.